So many a time, there are people who are bad to us. They don't behave very well with us. They are not very, you know, sweet to us, or they don't even reciprocate anything good that we do. So many things happen. But why is it that we are bad to ourselves, particularly when others are bad to us? See, the people who are so aggressive and so self-centered that others dare not be bad to us, those people are never bad to themselves. So both ways they are winners. People who are sensitive, people who are, you know, compassionate, people who care for others and all that, are anywhere at the receiving end from others. If you are not the dominating type, what will happen? Somebody else will try to dominate you. The moment you give in saying, after all, he is my friend, why should I argue? After all, she is my elder, why should I, you know, talk back to her? It's okay, maybe that person is doing it without bad intention, let me tolerate it. So what happens is, as it is, I am at the receiving end from others. And others continue to be bad to me. But the sad part is, we imbibe that so much that we start becoming bad to our own selves. And unlike anybody else, it may be your immediate family member, your spouse, your child, your parent, your sibling, it may be a friend, it may be an office colleague, it may be anybody, they all have limited time with you. The only person who is with you 24/7 is yourself. And if that person is not good to you, can you imagine how miserable life can be? But we choose to do that. Many of us choose to do that without even realizing. One is, as I said, you are with yourself 24/7. So if somebody else is bad to me, if my friend is bad to me, I can start reducing my meetings with him. If my colleague is bad to me, I can try and ignore and, you know, just do official work and get away immediately so that he doesn't get much of a chance to criticize me. Even if it is somebody at home, even if my spouse is criticizing me at bedtime, I can start snoring and pretend to be asleep. So somewhere I do have an escape from all others except myself. On top of that, if you look at it on a long-term basis, you don't like your spouse, you can divorce. You don't like your parents, you can move away when you grow up and be independent. You don't like your own child, you can push, you know, make him or her independent as fast as possible and kick him out of the house and say, okay, go and make your own life and for a change make others miserable. With everybody you have a chance of some sort of relief at some point or the other. Till the last day and your last breath, you have no divorce, you have no separation from yourself. And yet, something so important we tend to ignore. And unfortunately what happens is that once it starts becoming a habit, we don't even realize how often we do it. And I'll tell you the reason also why we do it. Supposing I feel that I don't have a good dressing sense. I'm not very particular. Now, it's not very important. You see, it is not immoral not to have a good dressing sense. It's not hurting anybody else. It's not financial burden on somebody. It's just that I'm a person who, okay, I wear clean clothes, I wash my clothes, but I don't bother ironing it. Or I don't bother to see whether it is matching. Or I don't bother to see that every day I must have a different variety of colors or something of that sort I'm doing. I'm not hurting anybody. But inevitably what happens, people start commenting about it. So every now and then, somebody or the other is making comments. And this includes close people and even casual people. There are even casual people who hardly know me. But the moment they see me, they think that they have a right to say, what is this, you are, you know, a trainer, teacher, you should be dressing a little better, why are you doing like this? So as it goes on and on and on, at one point what happens is that I start becoming defensive. Now I'm walking into the class more than focusing on what I have to tell you, my thoughts are, how many people over here will think that I am not properly dressed? So what is the best form of defense? Come here and say, sorry, I got up very early, late in the morning, and I was very busy, so I didn't have time to iron my shirt and so it's okay. Actually, you know, I'm not all that good in my dressing and this and that and something of that sort. Now, I am purposely drawing attention of people. Out of 50 people sitting here, maybe 10 may have felt that this fellow is not, you know, dressing very neatly. 40 people are not bothered about how he is dressing. They have come here to listen to a particular topic or for whatever purpose they have come. But I am drawing the attention of those 40 people. Now all 50 people think that I don't dress well. So what happens? Where 5 out of those 10 used to criticize me, now 25 out of 50 will criticize me. And I keep going deeper and deeper into that vicious cycle. There may come a point where I may say, no, I don't want to give this talk because people will think that, you know, he's not even dressed smartly and this and that, they will ridicule me. Now, I have a talent in something, I can be appreciated, even that I am giving up for something which is in no way connected to what I am doing. And I am getting sucked lower and lower till that comes to the point where I start saying that, see, the whole world is bad. Nobody appreciates me, nobody does this or that sort of thing. So, whenever you find that you have a shortcoming, just accept it. Ask yourself 2-3 basic questions. Most important, am I hurting somebody else? Is it causing inconvenience or discomfort or something to somebody else? Am I cheating somebody because of my, you know, lack of whatever quality? Is anybody getting cheated in the whole process? Am I depriving somebody of what should have rightfully been theirs? No. Is it immoral or unethical or illegal? No. So I just accept it as it is and I can, you know, move on.